thanks for your time this morning. It was a big day yesterday. At 70%, is it enough to keep us all safe?
Well, look, nothing's enough to keep us all safe if people don't do the right thing, Ali. So we're saying to everybody, it's 70% double dose vaccination. So long as all vaccinated people are only interacting with vaccinated people, it's a safe way to reopen. And all of us are looking forward to those freedoms. And the way that we've been putting up our arms and getting the jab has just been outstanding. I couldn't feel prouder of our citizens who are going through a very difficult time, but are really going out of the way to get vaccinated. We need to really keep that momentum going, because the quicker we get to that time, that 70% double dose, the quicker we can have all those freedoms. And it's everybody's choice whether you get vaccinated or not, but I've been very clear to say you won't be able to enjoy those freedoms we put out yesterday unless you are fully vaccinated, because at 70% double dose, there still be a considerable number of adults who aren't vaccinated, and that could impact the most vulnerable. It could impact, obviously, our hospitalisation rates, and we don't want to ever overwhelm our hospital systems more than they already are or will be. And so for that reason, we've taken a very cautious but fair plan to the people.
Premier, did you actually listen to the latest health advice, or was it a captain's call?
Oh, gosh, I listen to the health advice every day. And what we need to do is always weigh up that health advice with public policy. And I would never do anything where the health experts completely objected to anything or did not think was safe. And all along this journey, it's always been balancing the health risks with mental health and our ability to move freely and live with COVID. And we're definitely in a transition phase, and it's going to be challenging, but a road that all states will have to take, whether you like it or not. And, you know, I copped it when every state was telling me what we did right or wrong in New South Wales, but the inevitability of having to live with Delta is, I think, dawning on every single Premier and Chief Minister. Mm. But it's how you transition and how you keep as much of your population out of hospital as possible, which is the challenge for us. And I think we can all be very hopeful and look forward to what we can achieve and the freedoms we can have at 70%. Now, I certainly am. But also that we have to accept that there are still risks if you have a certain proportion of the adult population not vaccinated. But Dr. Chan and I are also confident that by the time we get to 70% double dose, we will have more than 80% of our adult population with more than one dose, or with at least one dose. So I'm hoping that by the time we get to that time in October, that at least 80 or 85% of our adults will have at least one dose, which is fantastic. And then 12 to 15-year-olds would have started being vaccinated by then as well. So there are inbuilt safeguards we've got until that time. And also the modelling that we have shows us we're likely to have a peak in our cases this week or next week. So the next 10 days are pretty critical in terms of us watching what the numbers are doing. We anticipate we will get a spike in cases, but then they'll start coming down because we've had a mad rush, a mad push to vaccinate our population. And we know the more people that are vaccinated, the less likely you're going to spread the disease.
Mm. So how did Kerry Chant react to you opening at 70%? Because we know of what we've read that she was pushing for 80-85.
Oh, no. The Doherty report, which all of the health advice... Well, that's the health advice that National Cabinet relied on. So what we've done in New South Wales is completely consistent with what all the state premiers signed off on. So at 70% double dose, there are certain freedoms you can have. And then at 80% double dose, there are certain freedoms you can have. Don't always believe what you read. I can tell you that...
OK, pushing for clarification. She wasn't pushing or preferring to wait until you'd reached 80 to 85%.
Oh, look, there's definitely further things we can do at 80% or 85%, which you can't do at 70. And that's why at 70 we stop short of doing other things that people want to do. Mm-hmm. And we've also said we've also excluded anyone who's not vaccinated. So if you're not vaccinated, you can't participate in any of the things we've outlined in the roadmap. The roadmap is only for those people who are double vaccinated, for people who are fully vaccinated. And I want to be very clear about that. The roadmap only applies if you are fully vaccinated. And that's why when fully vaccinated people meet with other fully vaccinated people, there is a level of comfort and a level of safety. But when we live with COVID, we will have everybody interacting with each other. Once you get to 80% double dose and there's more freedoms, whether it's at a workplace or whether it's at a venue or elsewhere, that then brings bigger challenges. So we've been very cautious to make sure at 70% our roadmap only applies to those who are fully vaccinated. And then obviously at 80%, which is the next step we're working on. So we've been working on the roadmap behind the scenes for 70%, and now we're working on what life looks like at 80%. So this is just our way of managing how we live with COVID and inevitability, which Australia will come to terms with. Every state's going to have to go through this. And we're confident that people will do the right thing. But when you use your QR code to get into a restaurant or wherever, that will also tell you whether you've been fully vaccinated. You won't be allowed inside a venue at 70% unless you are fully vaccinated. And they're the safeguards that will make sure we don't have high surging cases, which will end up in hospital. And that's what we worry about all the time. It's not so much people getting COVID. If you're fully vaccinated and healthy, there's no reason why you should end up in hospital. However, if you're not vaccinated, the chance of you ending up in hospital or intensive care is much higher. And that's what we need to protect against.
So given that, it's fair to say, is it not, Premier, that Kerry Chant wanted you to go to 80, 85 before any of these relaxations. That's fair to say, isn't it?
Well, no. Well, we will get to 80. We will have at least 80-85% first dose by the time we get to 70% double dose. And I'm not going to have anybody misquote or put out of context what the reality is. We always take on board the health advice. We always pull back what we know people want to do.
Well, I think people just want to know, Premier, whether it was your call or it's Kerry Chant's call. And I think everyone knows that Kerry Chant wanted it to be later, and you've called it earlier.
Well, who's what are you relying on that from, Kyle? Where are you getting that from?
Well, yesterday there was documents released from inside New South Wales Health that suggested that they wanted between 80 and 85. They were pushing for that, and you've gone at 70.
No, but this is what we've done is based on the national plan, where every chief medical officer, including the federal chief medical officer, had input into. So what we've done is it's actually a bit more conservative. It's not as ambitious as what some aspects of the national plan are. So what we've done is completely based on health advice, completely based on what is a safe thing to do. But it's all, as Dr. Chan always says, as I say, but it's up to us. If people break the rules, if people don't do the right thing, then it does compromise health and well-being. But that's why there are extra safeguards in place. Other countries around the world who opened up at 70% didn't have any of the restrictions or safeguards we had in place. They obviously started off from a higher base. They already had lots of cases and lots of hospitalisations. So the challenge for us is for everybody to stick to the plan, to not let loose, to keep making sure we obey the restrictions that are in place now. And obviously, when we open up or start opening up at 70%, we want to see the case numbers lower. We want to see less people with the disease, so that obviously we can manage the transition period as we live with COVID. And the interesting thing is, in New South Wales, it's only likely to be a few weeks between 70% and 80% double dose. Okay. If we work really hard, it might only be a couple of weeks between those two dates.
Well, my take out of that was that I can't cut loose, which I'm very aggrieved about.
You should be. Hey, look, Premier, there's been so much focus on when we'll be able to enjoy a beer at a pub. But why aren't kids back in the classroom? Why aren't we opening schools sooner when you said earlier in the week that schools are safe? Why is there a need for a staggered return?
Oh, I think all mums and dads and school communities would understand that with schools we need a fixed date. So I can't predict the exact date New South Wales will get to 70% double dose vaccination. But I do know that on the 25th of October we hope to have achieved that date by then. And with schools, they have to have weeks of planning. You need to make sure you have certainty. And so, unlike adults who are flexible and will know when a date arises and what we need to do, we wanted to make sure children, parents and school communities had certainty as to when schools were opening. And that's the reason why. And obviously, the best way, we had an expert in child COVID speak to us the other day, and she said the best way to protect children is to have maximum coverage of adults who are vaccinated. And obviously, our school safety plan reflects all of that. There'll be strict restrictions in place. And unlike adults who obviously can make arrangements, we wanted to make sure schools had certainty so they could plan ahead. And also parents could plan ahead as well. A lot of parents have been doing it so tough with home learning, as well as trying to hold down a job and trying to bring food on the table. So I think it was a relief for them to have that certainty, as opposed to saying, we're not quite sure what the date will be, just go with the flow. And, it doesn't work like that with children.
And just quickly, Premier, before we get to the news, a border solution. New South Wales and Queensland, they need to come to some sort of agreement here. How close are you? Have you and Anastasia been talking?
Look, I would hope that given there's been close to zero, I think zero cases, and we're opening up parts of northern New South Wales from tomorrow, actually, because we haven't had any cases there. So we've always been very generous in dealing with our Victorian counterparts, and we've had good arrangements with Victoria, and I hope the Queensland Government also sees fit, given that the northern border communities are interacting already. They're meeting at the border physically. There's been no cases in northern New South Wales. I think we just need to take a compassionate and open approach, and I hope the Queensland Government is a bit more relaxed about what's happening at the border.
Doesn't sound like we're too close to a resolution there from what you're saying. Hey, and I know that you're a Manly supporter. Knew you had class. They're going to win tonight?
That is...
I hope so. I'll have everything crossed. I think we took the Storm on last time and won against the odds, so I'm hoping it'll happen again.
That is not a word used to describe Manly supporters ever. Class. Thanks, Premier.